All right, pleasure being here. This is always one of the best meetings that we have around the state. Jenny, you do a great job. And it's always wonderful to come over here because there's a lot of familiar faces in the audience, a lot of folks that I consider to be friends. So it's a real honor to be here today. That's my information. When I saw that I was going to be on the program relatively early this morning, I thought, well, you know, I got to get up early and get going. And well, I get up early anyway, about 5 o'clock in the morning, because one of the things I like to do is get on the internet and check the what's happening in the world. You know, read the news. So, of course, this morning I did that, and unfortunately, the first thing I saw was there was another random mass shooting. And all you can do is ask why. A couple weeks ago, though, I read something that really touched my heart, made me feel good. It was about coffee, and I like my coffee. Now, this particular report was associated with drinking 3 or 4 cups of coffee a day, and it was stating that it kind of countered the effects of the alcohol, if you like, an adult beverage. And of course, I enjoy an adult beverage from time to time, so I thought, yeah, this is good. I'll take that one and put it in my pocket, because it fits what I do all right. About a month and a half ago, and of course, you can't avoid this on a daily basis, the presidential campaigns, you know, ongoing, relentless. We still got a long way to go. But this article was about the impacts of stress on the candidates during the season. And there was so much stress for one of the leading candidates that that candidate decided, you know, I really need to get some help with this. And that candidate decided to seek the assistance of a therapist. So got the appointment with the therapist, went to the office. The therapist said, well, first of all, I want you to feel comfortable. So please go over there, sit on the couch. If you feel like laying down on the couch, please do so. And once you get comfortable, just tell me what's bothering you. The candidate said, well, I feel like the weight of the world is on my shoulders, and I just can't shake that feeling. Therapist interrupted and said, well, okay, that's a considerable amount of pressure, and that's going to cause a lot of stress, but really, I think what we need to do is go to the beginning and find out sort of how you got to this point of feeling all of this stress. Candidate took a deep breath, said, yeah, I think that's a really good idea. And after a couple seconds, started out, in the beginning, I created the heavens and the earth. So anyway, sometimes you feel that way with the way these campaigns are going. Couple of things I want to talk about this morning. The first is corn nitrogen management. Let me get rid of this cup of coffee here now. And I won't stand in front of that one. And it's going to be a focus on timing. I talked about nitrogen management in corn last year. So I'm not going to belabor all of the points that I addressed with you last year, but I do want to go back and focus on this issue of timing. And in particular, you're starting to see a lot of talk about later applications of corn. So we're going to try to address that a little bit. The other thing I'm going to talk about is this issue of wheat quality. There's some things that are changing this year regarding the purchase of wheat, and I just want to focus on number one, what is wheat quality, and number two, how do you get that? All right, before I start though, and as always, a big thank you. Those of you that participate in the checkoff programs with the Maryland Grain Producers, the Maryland Soybean Association, Maryland Crop Improvement Association, or if you're a supporter of the Maryland Agroecology Center, all of those programs have provided assistance to my program. Assistance both financially and in a lot of cases, I get to interact with the farmers that are part of these organizations, and I learn a lot from that. A heartfelt thank you to you for that participation. And since I'm saying thank you, and I realized a while back, the work I do around the state I couldn't accomplish without the assistance I get from the research farm staffs. Got the folks from the Y here today. I see folks from our Beltsville farm here today. Both of those farms I do a lot of work at. Do work at all the other farms. And just a big thank you to those folks, as well as the technicians and graduate students that come through my program that do a lot of help for me. I wouldn't be able to get done what I do without all of that help. So thank you very much. Now, an alert. On about January 2nd, I guess, and I don't know if you can see this very well, but this is a picture of wheat. Jim Lewis sent it to me, and it was heading. Now, it was wheat that was growing down very close, I guess, to the St. Michael's area, I believe, and it was planted as cover crop. Not planted that early. Late September. Kind of surprising that it was heading at that point in time. Now, this was just before we had temperatures that dipped into the teens, the first time this winter, because we certainly didn't have that in November and December. Those were the temperatures that caused this to happen. Now, of course, because it was cover crop wheat, Mother Nature did that farmer a favor, and it smoked it. What was disturbing was this right here, and Jim and others were telling me that they were hearing about and seeing some fields, not all fields, some fields where barley and wheat were starting to joint. Now, why that was a concern is because once the crop starts to joint, the growing point extends from below the soil to above the soil. And joining, you all know what joining is when you can feel that node above the soil surface on those stems, right? Now, why that's critical, cold temperatures are going to have an impact on that, but why that's critical and starting to join at that point in time is because that's when that transition occurs from vegetative growth in the wheat crop to the reproductive growth stage. The reason I'm bringing this to your attention is because we had, I don't know, 3 or 4 days that we had temperatures in the teens. It got pretty cold right there for a while. The crop hadn't had an opportunity to really harden off like it usually does. Usually temperatures slowly cool down and the crop goes into a dormancy or at least a semi-dormant state. And this year it really didn't do that as we walked through December. It's because of this reason right here. Winter kill potential. There may be some out there. Wheat that was starting to joint at that point in time, you may see some winter kill. Now I'm not getting a lot of reports that this is happening. And I wouldn't expect it to be widespread. Might be just spots in the field that this may have happened. But what I want to recommend that you do is at least check your fields if you think you may be having a problem. Number one, see whether or not you're adjoining, if those nodes have gotten above the soil surface. And this is particularly important because MDA did announce that as of February 15th, your first application of nitrogen could go on the crop. Mother Nature hasn't been too cooperative about allowing that to happen since the announcement came out, but when you get the opportunity to get out there, you can put that nitrogen out there. But in order to test for winter kill, you can do a couple things. One, you can dig up some plants, you can place them in pots, you can bring them indoors, let them warm up and let them grow and just see what happens. It may take a few days in those types of conditions for them to start dying off, or they may continue to grow. If they continue to grow, you're fine. The other thing, and it may be a quicker test for you, is this bottom one right here. Dig up the plants, clean off the soil, put the plants into a sealed plastic bag, keep them in a warm place, and watch them for a couple days. And if the crown area of the plant starts to turn brown, chances are you had some damage. If they don't, if they remain that creamy white color, you're fine. So just a word of caution there. Hopefully, you know, come back next year, you'll look at me and say that damn Kratochvil doesn't know what he's talking about. There wasn't any winter kill whatsoever. I hope that is the case. But I just want to alert you about this potential, given the type of weather that we've had this year. All right, last year I did talk about corn nitrogen management. I introduced this to you, and a lot of you probably have seen this before, the 4 R's of nitrogen management. IPNI, or the International Plant Nutrition Institute, has really been promoting this. The R stands for right, and the 4 things are source, or your fertilizer products that you use, the rate, how much that crop is going to require, timing, When is that optimum application time? And that's what I'm going to focus on, is optimum time of application. What you want to avoid, and this is corn that's just about ready to tassel, you don't want to look down those rows and see all those yellow leaves. You want green leaves in that bottom canopy at that stage of the game. Okay? And the last thing there is the placement. Where do you put that nitrogen to get the most efficient use from it? Okay, we're going to start with a little bit of soil fertility 101, though. No matter what nitrogen source you use, there are two forms of nitrogen that the plant can take up. You got the nitrate form, you got the ammonium form. Of course, the nitrate form is the one that is taken up the most. And I think you'll understand why in just a little bit. Form. Okay, I give up. I'll stand over here. All right. The form determines how it behaves, and it's primarily because of the charge that's on the molecule. On the nitrates, you've got a negative charge. On the ammonium, you've got a positive charge. So let's just look at what happens to each of those forms as you place them out in your field, okay? The ammonium, we're going to start with, and ultimately your goal is to get the crop to consume the ammonium. Now, what you have in the soil are a lot of negative charges. Charges on your organic matter, charges on your clay particles. Those negative charges are good because you've got a positive charge there on the ammonium. They're going to attract. It's like a magnet. So you get your ammonium into the soil, you're going to get it bound, which is good. Okay? You reduce the risk of loss. Now, weather both helps with this and it can hurt with this. If you get rain shortly after you've put your nitrogen out there, it's going to wash it into the soil. And you're going to get that binding that occurs between those negative and positive charges. If it's dry, you got your ammonium fertilizer on the surface of the soil, you have the risk of losing some of that through volatilization. How does that happen? Well, there's an enzyme present in the soil. It's ubiquitous. And what it does, this enzyme likes hydrogen. It's going to strip a hydrogen off of that ammonium. When you take a hydrogen away from ammonium, you have ammonia. And ammonia is a gas, and it'll readily volatilize into the atmosphere. It's why sometimes you can put UAN out. If you surface apply and it's hot and dry, you will smell a little bit of ammonia. It's volatilizing. It's also why, if you're using manure on your fields, there is a recommendation that tillage will incorporate it into the soil to tie up that ammonium. Or why we recommend at the university that you inject your side dress nitrogen. Get it into the soil so you minimize the loss potential that can occur. Okay, now you got your ammonium into the soil. Things don't stop there, because you got nitrification bacteria in the soil that, like ammonium, they like these hydrogen ions on it, and they're going to strip off those hydrogen ions, and it's going to be replaced with oxygens, and you get nitrate, the other form. And that's why plants take up more nitrate form than they do the ammonium form, typically because there's just more of an opportunity to get the nitrate. All right, so let's look at what happens with nitrate. Negative charges in the soil. Got a negative charge on our nitrate. Not so good. Now, they repel, like similar poles on magnets do. They repel. Now, that's okay, because that puts the nitrate into the soil solution, the water that's in the soil, and that's how the plants are actually going to take it up. Got to remember, though, that both nitrogen uptake and nitrogen loss are driven by hydrology. In other words, what's going on both with Mother Nature and how much water you have in the soil. If it's dry, that pump system that the plant has, pulling that water and nutrients into it, isn't functioning nearly as well. you get rain, keep that soil moisture in good condition, optimum condition, then you're getting, that pump is firing off like it should. Now, if you get too much rain and you have sloping soils, you do stand the potential for to have some erosion loss, you know, washing it off of the soil and the soil particles. Okay, if you have waterlogged soils, or those soils that don't drain well, and they stay that way for a while, what's happening then is the nitrate is converted to nitrous dioxide, nitrous oxide, nitrogen gas, and it can, through this denitrification process, dissipate into the atmosphere. So you're losing it. And the other thing is, if you have these lighter soils, all soils will leach. Sandier soils are more prone to leaching loss more quickly than heavier soils are, but all soils will leach. With too much moisture in the soil, you get that movement of the nitrate down through the soil and out of the root zone, and in some cases further down into the soil where it gets into the groundwater, and you're all aware of the issues that can occur. So, all right, so in regards to timing, first rule, do not put all your nitrogen out up front. This is a growth chart. Planted your corn, it emerges, and this is days after emergence. And over here we've got percent of nitrogen uptake that occurs at these different stages or periods of time after the crop has emerged. And of course, early on, those first 30 days or so, 40 days after you've planted, you're not consuming very much nitrogen. The plants are small. It makes sense why you're not consuming very much nitrogen. Maybe 10, 15% 30 days after emergence is what's been consumed. It's why we recommend 25 to 35% of the nitrogen that's going to be supplied is done with pre-plant. Don't go higher than that. Giving it a starter is good, but don't get too carried away with how much you put out there, and don't put out all of it pre-plant. Too many opportunities for loss. Okay, now of course, this is the stage where the crop is just about ready to take off and have that rapid growth. And you want your nitrogen there at that point in time. So that's when you come out, about V4, V5 stage, and you start doing your side dress applications. Okay, if you are going to side dress, and hopefully you are, one of the things to do is the PSNT test if you have a history of manure, or you use sewage sludge, or a legume, and I'm talking not so much soybean, but if you had a hay crop out there, an alfalfa crop recently, that can contribute a lot of nitrogen to you, do the PSNT test to find out how much nitrogen you have available at that point in time that you're going to side dress your crop. You may learn that you've got more there than you think you have, and that you can cut back on the amount that you're going to supply in the side dress operation. How many of you use it? Work with your nutrient management consultants, and those of you that use it, do you feel it's worthwhile? Have you seen good results, or okay, like anything in agriculture, huh? Kind of, yeah. Okay, well, it's another tool that's available to you. All right, so we're at this side dress stage where, because of the equipment that we have available, for the most part, this is when we're supplying the rest of the nitrogen that's going to be consumed by the crop. That 75, 80% of the nitrogen at this point in time, which is good because this is the period of time when it's going to be consuming it. From about right here on, you only got about a month and a half before the majority of it will have been consumed by the crop. So that's when you want to have it on. Okay, so what about later applications? Getting a lot of press right now, and they make sense. If you have an irrigation system and you can put it on through the system, I mean, you're kind of spoon feeding that crop as you're going through that rapid growth. There's also equipment out there, these high boy applicators, that can put the nitrogen out there for you as well. So there are ways that you can get it out there. if you are going to do it, tassel stage is probably about where you want to stop. And we'll talk about why here with this slide right here. Now, from V8, got corn about this high, to tassel stage, that crop's taking up between 4 and 8 pounds of nitrogen a day. I mean, it's really utilizing it. Once you get to pollination stage, about 2 weeks after, you've consumed 80 to 90% of the nitrogen that the crop's going to consume. At that point in time, you got grain fill going on, nitrogen supplied to the crop, you're not going to be picking up that much more nitrogen as far as growth is concerned, because the vegetative growth has really stopped. You've switched over into that reproductive growth phases. So if you do an ultralight application, do it by the VT stage, the tassel stage. Purdue University did a study on normal side dress application compared to coming in later, V15 or tassel stage. This was probably about 3 years ago. It followed a year when farmers had a real bear of a time getting side dress nitrogen because they had a wet June out there. And there were a lot of farmers that had to go later with getting their side dress nitrogen on. So the following year, Purdue wanted to look at this question about what happens if we miss our V7 application and have to go in later. Got different nitrogen rates here that were side dressed, and there's the grain yield that we got. The blue bar signifies the normal side dress application. The red bar, which they're pretty comparable up to about 150 pound application, then they kind of slid off, and this is about where you're maximizing your yield. So what that basically says is, if you can get it out, that normal side dress time, you're going to be better off than having to come in and do a rescue at tassel stage. So lesson there is, if at all possible, don't miss your normal side dress application time. So my take on all of this, I do not recommend going with a late application if you can get out and do your normal side dress application using best management practices. And those are side dress during that V5 to V8 stage, knife it in, or stream it in a band on the soil between the rows. And if you are going to surface, if you're using surface applied urea or UAN, protect it with a volatilization inhibitor, a product such as Agritain, Agritain Plus. There's others out there. These two I know work to minimize that risk of losing some of that ammonium during that stage, particularly if it's dry weather. All these products are going to do is buy you a few days. About 5 is typically what you get. And what you're hoping for is if you surface applied and it's dry, hot, you're going to get a rain event in those 5 days that will help take it into the soil for you. All right, I do not recommend skipping that normal side dress application. If you do an ultralight application, do it by VT. Have weights on the drop nozzles if you're going through with one of those high boys so that they're not slopping all over the place and splashing up onto your lower leaves. I mean, they are contributing some to what's going on with that plant, so you want to protect them as best you possibly can. And most importantly, be aware of the cost of either upgrading equipment so you can put out late application, or what it's going to cost to hire a custom applicator. I think, you know, prices aren't good right now. You got to have as sharp a pencil as you possibly can. All right, now, some new technology, and maybe it's not that new anymore, but it's this Y-drop system. Any of you heard or seen anything with these Y-drops? Well, DuPont Pioneer's been doing some research with these, and this is just the results of some of the work that they did. They had an untreated a treatment that was untreated. In other words, they didn't use any additional side dress nitrogen. And first thing that I noticed with this work was they had a heck of a lot of nitrogen out there to begin with. And they weren't getting a lot of bump with their side dress application. They used Super U or slow release granular product. Kicked up yield just a little bit, probably not statistically significant, but broadcast at the V8. They came in, normal side dress time, colder injection system, still, not a whole heck of a lot of response, but where they did see response was with this Y-drop system at the V14 stage, or that tassel time, and they kicked yield up about 7 to 10 bushel to the acre. Now, the whole idea of the Y-drop is get those things dropping that nitrogen right next to each row, getting it closer to the row than the center of the row, which is about the best you can do if you're injecting with colder injectors or even if you're dribbling down the center of the row. So you're getting that nitrogen closer to the row. It makes sense that that's a benefit to you. Oh, just one other thing. Talking with an individual last week about this system, and apparently it's costly at about $1,500 to $2,000 per unit. So, you know, if you're going to outfit a 12 or 18 row applicator, it's going to be costly for you to do that. So, again, that's why if you're going to consider a change like this, put a pencil to it to see if it's going to be valuable, because your actual bang for the buck may not be as great as you think it will be. All right, any questions about core nitrogen management, timing, etc., before I switch gears here? How am I doing for time, Jenny? Time is no object at this meeting. Just as long as lunch is warm. That's right. All right, wheat quality. What is it and how do you get it? All right, it's the suitability of the wheat for the end-use products. That's what it boils down to. It's not one single property. It's a combination of the physical, the milling, the chemical, the baking. All of those things combined make what actual wheat quality is. Now, here you are in this supply chain. This group right here is what ultimately determines wheat quality. And that gets fed back to this individual here who's the wheat breeder, to include that as another factor or factors in the process of breeding, making the crosses, and then making the selections as far as a variety that will yield, have good test weight. Those are things you're interested in. Disease resistance. But on top of that, has to be concerned about this individual down here. Okay? Purdue sent a letter September 21st of last year describing that there's going to be a change in quality specifications. Basically what they said was the previous specs for number 2 soft red winter wheat, 2 parts per million vomitoxin, 58 pound test weight, were going to change. And they're going to shift to 1.25 parts per million vomitoxin, or this Dawn that you hear about, in those years we have scab outbreaks, and a minimum of 59.3 pounds per bushel test weight. What they are going to do in order to encourage that is, number one, they're going to do load-by-load vomitoxin testing when the grain comes in, something I think they already do in those years when we've had a scab outbreak. A nickel per bushel premium if you have vomitoxin 1 part per million or less. Now, in order to encourage increased test weight, they're going to give a half cent per bushel for every tenth of a pound per bushel. In other words, if you got 59 pound wheat, you're going to get a nickel. If you got 60 pound wheat, you're going to get a dime. And they will not discount for moisture until it's greater than 15%. All right, so let's just talk a little bit about the things that impact quality in this region. These are the three main things we hear about: vomitoxin, test weight, falling number. We'll talk a little bit about each of them. Vomitoxin, and I see Nathan back there. You're going to talk about scab. Okay, we're gonna go through this one really quick then, because Nathan is here and he's much more of an expert about scab and vomitoxin things than I am. But it's when you see those bleached heads in the field following a scab infection at usually it's around flowering time, heading time of the crop. Those pink or salmon colored spores on a lot of those bleached heads. You've all seen it. I'm sure you have. Well, in the end, you can end up with tombstone kernels in your grain. They don't weigh anything, and they're the ones that are most likely to have DAWN in them. So, why does it occur so frequently here? And quickly, we're going to look at the disease triangle. You need three things for an infection to occur. You've got to have the pathogen, you have to have a host, and you have to have the weather. We have the pathogen present all the time because Fusarium or scab overwinters on all cereals in this area. We follow our corn crop with wheat. So the pathogen is there. That's a given, and we provided the host for it. Then if we get the right conditions, the right weather conditions, we get an infection. This describes it a little bit better. I don't want to belabor it because Nathan will talk about it. But you got a cornfield, you plant your wheat into it. You go out in that cornfield during the winter and you see black specks on a lot of those stems, which are they're doing a good thing as far as degrading the corn stover. But they're also spores that have the potential when that crop flowers, either through air currents, or this is the one that's even more of a problem. We get those rain events, rainy weather, that period of time when the wheat is flowering, and those spores can be splashed up and they then locate in the spikelets. And then about 2-3 weeks later you start seeing these kinds of conditions in your field. All right, so what can you do? Avoid planting no-till into corn stalks. That'd be one thing. Plant after soybean. That's likely not to be a major way of avoiding this. We grow a lot of corn here and we put a lot of wheat in behind it. Soybeans come off a little bit later. It's not as easy to get that wheat in behind soybeans. So this is likely to continue. You can select varieties with better tolerance or resistance. This is a report that the University of Maryland used to put out on an annual basis. The last time was, I believe, 2013. What it was a misted nursery. All entries that were in the state wheat test were put into this nursery. The site was inoculated with Fusarium. Make sure you had the inoculum there. And then it was misted while those wheat varieties were heading and flowering to create that opportunity for infection on these different varieties. And then seed from all of those varieties were analyzed for concentration of DAWN and a number of other things. And then they were kind of rated like this. You can see the last report that was there. If you visit this site, a lot of the varieties that were being used at that time may not even be included here. However, there is hope. This year, the nursery is planned again. Jason White at the University of Maryland, the new variety trials coordinator that we have, working with Nathan Klukshevsky at Delaware, are planning to do the misted nursery this year. So you should be able to visit this site later in the summer and get some idea again of what varieties are less susceptible or more susceptible to scab. Another thing you can do is visit the Prediction Center. How many of you have visited this site? It's a great place to go during that period of time when the crop is heading, because it will tell you what your risk is at that point in time. It's managed by Penn State University. What it allows you to do is go in, select the type of wheat you're growing, because scab is a problem for all wheat, for all barley, for all cereals, for that matter. Select what you're growing, whether you have a susceptible or a moderately resistant variety. You're not going to find any varieties out there that are 100% resistant to scab. They don't exist. What we've got is kind of a type 2 resistance where previously, varieties that got infected by scab, the scab would move throughout the head. Now that infection will pretty much remain localized for those moderately resistant varieties that are available. You can select your date, you can predict how far out you want to forecast, and it's going to give you a map like this that will show what the risk potential is. If it's red or yellowish, it indicates that there's some risk and that you may be prepared, or you better be prepared, to maybe take action if it continues that way. Now, this was April 22nd of last year. It was the lower shore part of Delaware that was high risk, and that pretty much was the end of the scab risk last year. It was a year that we had a pretty dry May, and that pretty much ended it. So there's some years, most of May, the state will be colored red or yellow, fairly high risk. All right, so be prepared to apply fungicide if necessary. Prosaro and Corumba are a couple that are good. Aerial application if you can arrange it, but you got to realize you're going to maybe have a short window for getting this stuff out. So if you've got the potential to do it with ground equipment, might be a better option. And what else can you do if about 2 or 3 weeks after the crop is headed, you start seeing these bleached heads? The first thing to do is contact your insurance agent. Let them know, invite them out, have them look at those fields so that you're on record that I have the potential here for a problem and my wheat may not sell because of high levels of DON. All right, if you're harvesting, you start seeing some of those tombstones in your grain, turn up the fan speed, blow them out the back. They're light, they're not going to contribute to your yield. If you're worried about getting too many out there and you're going to see green rows through the field, probably won't be that significant because these white kernels aren't going to germinate anyway. So get them out of there. Put the minimum possible into your grain bins. Now, when you do bin the crop, if it's not the whole farm that had a scab problem, bin it separately if you possibly can. Don't commingle your good grain with your scabby wheat. No sense risking that chance of it all being rejected when you should be able to protect the good stuff from the bad. Keep the wheat dry while in storage and test the wheat before selling. Okay, let's talk about test weight and quality and what does it measure. And I know you hear people out there say, oh my gosh, good test weight. That's the ultimate as far as determining the quality of that crop. Well, that's really a bunch of hooey because test weight doesn't really indicate anything related to milling or baking quality. Soft Wheat Quality Lab in 2007, and they get hundreds of samples of different varieties of wheat. They evaluated those samples, compared the test weight to a number of quality characteristics. Flour yield, you'd think because you have a higher test weight wheat you're getting more flour out of it. That's not necessarily the case. Cookie diameter, flour ash, there's a number of characteristics there they tested it to. None of them correlated with quality. This was 2007. We could do that same study now with the varieties that are available. The outcome would be the same. Test weight does not indicate milling and baking quality. What it does indicate is the bulk density of the grain. If you're shipping wheat, if you're putting it into the hold of a ship and sending it overseas, that's important. If you're putting it in a truck and transporting it, it's important. If you're storing it, it's important, but that's about the extent of it. All right, so how do you get good test weight? Well, when selecting varieties, one of the things you can do is select those that have the highest test weight. Now, this is where I'm a little concerned about the premium that's offered, because what I think folks are going to do is look at the highest test wheat varieties out there, and those are what they're going to select. They'll also look to see if they yield and a couple other things, but I think there'll be a real focus on test weight. And I think what's going to happen is we may narrow the pool of varieties that we have, which if we narrow the pool of varieties that are growing in a region, we are much more susceptible to having some shifts in disease. If that makes sense to y'all. Harvest early and dry the wheat. Start harvest when you got 18 or 20% moisture. Dry it down. If you got a dryer on the farm, run through that dryer quickly and dry it down. That'll help maintain the maximum test weight, because once we hit about 18, 20%, we have reached maximum test weight for the most part. Those kernels have shrunk down. Okay? So you're gonna maintain that test weight. It also gains you a couple days, maybe even close to a week, as far as being able to plant your double crop beans, and the sooner you get your double crop beans in, the better off you are. All right, so now we're going to switch to falling number. This is one other factor as to why test weight is important. Mills across the region, when they start seeing an overall decline in test weight during harvest season, they start thinking about falling number. The reason why is because that's telling them that we've got a region that's probably having some rain events during harvest, kind of like we had last year. And what happens, you've got that kernel kind of shrunk to its smallest size, and you're getting the most kernels into that test weight container at that point in time, and you're maximizing your test weight. You get rain events, those kernels will imbibe some water, and they will start swelling. Now, they will swell, even though you get good drying weather afterwards, they will not shrink back down. They will stay at that size, and the next rain event you get, they swell a little bit more and a little bit more. And that's why as we go through harvest seasons with rainy weather, we see a decline in test weight as we move on. So that's, and they're concerned, the industry's concerned about falling number, the impact of pre-harvest sprouting. So let's just look at a wheat kernel. What happens when we have pre-harvest sprouting? Why is this important? We've got a wheat kernel here. Got our bran, we've got our germ, and we've got our endosperm, and the endosperm is the flower. It's the most important part. 70, 75, 77% of that kernel is endosperm. Let's look a little bit more closely at what this endosperm is. It's starch. What's starch? Starch are sugar molecules joined together in chains. Okay, imbibition of water starts the process. And that kernel of wheat does not know it's destined to be a cookie. That kernel of wheat, the only thing it wants to do is reproduce itself. So what is it going to do when it gets water? It's going to start the germination process. The germination process starts, you have an enzyme called alpha amylase, pretty much housed right along there between the endosperm and the wheat germ. Get water in the kernel, the alpha amylase starts migrating through the starch, and it's like a scissors. It starts cleaving these starch molecules. And what you start getting are individual sugar molecules mixed in with that flour. Now, having more sugar in that flour has the potential to affect the flour's baking properties. So how do they measure sprout damage? And this is where the falling number test comes into play and what it actually is. The American Association of Cereal Chemists have about a 40-page document that describes how to do the falling number test. What this is the Reader's Digest version of that. Take a sample of wheat. It is ground. Water is added to it to form a slurry. They then heat that slurry and stir it. That causes that starch to gelatinize or thicken up. Okay? Now, what happens if you've had sprouting? You get starch thinning. So they take this tube with that slurry, they put a rod at the top of it in this fancy machine here, and they just release that rod and they measure how much time it takes for that rod to drop down through the tube. If you've got sound wheat, 300, 350, 400, 450 seconds for it to drop. Your wheat's fine. If you've had sprouted wheat, and if it's really sprouted, it may drop through in 60 seconds. You've got severe sprout. What conditions cause sprouting? Well, the wheat has reached maturity. You get rainy weather. Much like we saw in 2015, combines are sitting in the shed and you got about a week of rainy weather and wish you could be in the field, but you can't. We generally see it about once every 5 years. It's not that uncommon in this region. It may not be widespread across the entire region, but there might be some localized areas that have some real problems with it. What does it do? Well, it's always detrimental to cakes. Cookies sometimes affected. The reason cookies are affected is because the spread of that cookie, and it doesn't matter to us if we're baking the cookies in the kitchen. That's no problem if the cookie gets a little bit bigger. Those are the ones I always like the best. But Keebler's is concerned because they got pre-sized packaging material and they've got a mechanical process of putting those cookies in. If you've got a cookie that's too big, it's not going to fit in that package material. So they're very concerned about it. Pretzel industry is very concerned, primarily because there's a lot more mechanization in making these pretzels than there used to be, and they need consistency of that flour. So they can't afford to have falling number issues. Most of the other products that are made from soft red winter wheat, batters and Chinese noodles and those sorts of things, really aren't affected at all by it. So, how do you avoid pre-harvest sprouting? Variety differences do exist. They're linked to the amount of dormancy that variety has at harvest time, when it's reached harvest maturity, and most seeds will have a dormancy period. It can be anything from very short to, and you've heard of some weed seeds that will survive for years, remain dormant. Okay? Well, wheat's the same way. The varieties do have a range of dormancy, but there's no routine screening done to know which ones are more dormant and which ones are less dormant. It's just one of those things that the breeders haven't focused on. In 2006, we had a season that had varying amounts of rain across the state. The state test was harvested at Poplar Hill that year. It had no rainfall on it at all. We got samples from that location, ran falling numbers on it, and for the most part, we had excellent falling numbers. Now, there were variety differences. The variety Chesapeake was relatively low to start with. McCormick, very high. Keedysville had a couple of rain events. We got samples, did the same thing with them, and you can see that there were some changes occurring. For instance, this variety right here had dropped to about half. Still, probably wheat that if it was blended would be okay. The Y got hammered that year with rain. Now, the interesting thing here is, and this points out that you have variety differences, is McCormick hung on across the board. This variety here, it almost like it smelled water. And the falling number started dropping. So, how do you minimize the problem? All varieties are going to sprout given the right conditions. Harvest early is one way, particularly if the forecast is saying next week is going to be wet, rainy, and your crop is at about 18 to 20% and you can dry it down. You might want to get out there and go after it. Now, another thing that affects this dormancy period are cool temperatures during late grain fill. It shortens that dormancy period. So if you have a cooler than normal period in, say, mid-June, 1st of June to mid-June, you might be wanting to think in terms of, hey, maybe we're going to be more susceptible to sprout if we have a rainy period. But the only real option to minimizing sprout damage is start doing this about the middle of June. You don't want rainy weather during that period of time. All right. Thank you all. Is there any time for questions or? So. Anyone got any questions? Yes.
How long does it take to run a falling numbers test? If you're sitting there with a loaded semi, how are you going to figure this out?
Well, I guess it depends upon how many they have to run. If you're hauling it to the mill and you're getting a determination at that point in time, falling number test, you probably run it in about 30 minutes pretty easily. Grind the wheat, add the water, heat it up, put it in the machine. Depends upon how many machines they have, etc. One of the things you might want to do, if you know you went through a season, harvest season, and you got some sprout in your grain, you might want to take a sample in early just to find out where you are.
Matt Taylor is here with Root Rain Irrigation LLC. So Matt, thanks for coming today. Is this your first time here?
Yeah. Good. Who knows what subsurface drip irrigation is? Is there a pretty good amount of you? So we design, install, and service subsurface drip irrigation here on the shore. We have some systems in that have been very successful. We've seen quite a bit of nitrogen savings. He talked about being able to put nitrogen on throughout the growing year. We do petiole sampling, plant tissue sampling to determine what, how much nitrogen that crop needs and when to put it on. But we can also put a lot of micronutrients through. So by making the plant healthier altogether, you have quite a bit of nitrogen savings. We saw about 25% savings with a 40 bushel yield bump 1 year versus a pivot that was side dressed with just a sprayer. So there's a lot of savings there. If you have any questions, you can ask me. We have a booth out here down on the end. Some of the other advantages, we can do any shape or size field, doesn't matter. And if you have low water, if you don't have enough water to pump for a pivot, a lot of times we can at least get a good chunk of that farm and do it efficiently. So if you have any questions, stop by and see me.
Thanks, Matt. John Murdoch is here from Baker Ag Lime. So yep. Thanks, John.
Thank you. Absolutely. Thank you for having me. Thank you for putting on this event. I'm John Murdoch here with Baker Lime. For those of you that may know Baker Lime, you may know Steve Morrison. He's still with the company. He's working in R&D now. I think everybody here knows lime's value in neutralizing soil acidity, adjusting the pH so you got access to those micronutrients, something that Bill touched on earlier. And then, of course, you got the nutrients that you can supply, like calcium and magnesium. Baker Lime, we're located in York, Pennsylvania, so about 18 miles north of the Mason-Dixon line. And we have all high magnesium limestone, both pulverized and pelletized. We work with a couple distributors and dealers in this area, Crop Production Services, Southern States, some other local folks as well. If you have any questions, we do have a booth out there. Please stop by and see us. And I just wanted to say thank you for everybody who does participate in this industry, for helping feed my family, help feed me and our nation and beyond. Thank you.
Jeff Harris is here from Crop Production Services.
My name is Jeff Harris with Crop Production Services. I've been with the company 15 years, moved up here in July, moved to Chestertown to show my commitment to you guys that we're here for you. We are full service seed, chemical, fertilizer. For those of you that do it yourself, we can take care of you as well. Our Dynagrow seed manager is here, Will Betts. He's at our booth. Also, our Echelon Precision Ag Precision Ag manager, Tara Tatman, she is here. She can show our scouting program that we have, along with different precision ag components that we can offer you. Scouting program, tissue sampling. Anhydrous, you guys know we do have anhydrous there. We do offer anhydrous stabilizer. That it's a little bit difficult, but we can offer that if you are interested. So any of you guys that are using anhydrous, if you're interested in a stabilizer in your anhydrous, we can offer it to you. We have to kind of meet with you one-on-one to go through how that's offered to you. Also, ESN, slow-release fertilizer, we offer that. You saw slides earlier today about how being efficient with your nitrogen, and we can broadcast that, you know, over the top with dry rigs down the row if that's something you're interested. Again, thank you very much. Thank you for your business.
Many of you know John Hall, retired county ag agent from Kent County, and actually my mentor when I first came to be the county ag agent. But John now works with the Maryland Department of Ag with crop insurance. So, John, thanks.
2 points I'd like to share. First of all, Bob mentioned, or Bob Kratochvil mentioned the thing about vomitoxin. There is a component in your insurance if you have insurance, but for those of you that store out of the field, you need to get that test in right away, because evidently that is a component of crop insurance, but there's only a very few approved labs to get that done, and there's a handout back there. The other thing, for those of you that are my age or older, we got to think big picture sometimes in terms of cycle. And I go back to 2006, because I also do marketing stuff, as you know. You know what happened in 2006? Basically, that's when ethanol was getting started. Does anyone know how much corn production in the United States ethanol uses as far as the total corn production? It uses about a third of the normal production. And what's kind of interesting, and it's kind of a mixed bag for you guys. You're too damn good. Because in 2006, our surpluses were getting right high, and that's why price was depressed. Now what happens is the American farmer has increased kind of their production a third to take in all the ethanol that's being produced. And now we're right back where we were back in 2006 as far as the surpluses. And the interesting thing about it is productivity in agriculture is in the United States as well as overseas, because China's production is growing at that same rate. So, I mean, it's You know, you live long enough, you always see these cycles, and I wish the cycle was profitability rather than productivity, but it came back to bite you a little bit.
Greg Holland is here from Helena. Thanks, Greg.
I just wanted to thank everybody for all the business that you've given Helena. And, you know, we really try to do our best. It's a challenging market, and, you know, and we've always tried to stay up with technology. The biggest things, like we hear a lot about nutrient management, I write nutrient management plans. The more time you can spend looking over your soil samples and talking to somebody about it, it'll pay off exponentially for you, you know, to just know your farms better. And, you know, we try to portray that a lot, you know, with our agri-intelligence, you know, our Varis mapping. You know, one thing about it, we don't do custom map in this area. We've got a field scout that does all that. We make, you know, what we feel are really solid agronomic recommendations, and we actually work with our competitors so that they're applying the fertilizer that we're actually recommending. And we've, you know, I've had some competitors that actually acknowledge that the people that we have do that, you know, they were really on top of everything. So, but once again, I appreciate that, and just, you know, we look forward to hopefully a as profitable year as we can. Thank you.